No, actually the talk will be about porting Erlang to OSV operating system, the saving the, from robots it, next year. So my name is Zvi Avraham, and I'm Erlang developer like yourself. I'll be talking today about operating systems, but I'm not an operating system developer. I'm not a Linux kernel hacker, but I'm fascinated about new technology called unikernels, and I think Erlang developers need to be aware about it and use it. So let's start. So there's a thing called compartmentalization. This word is so long, it itself has multiple compartments. So what's compartments? Compartment means separating something with compartments. It was first used in shipbuilding industry, where you separate part of the ship with the compartments, and in case you have a leak, the water will flow only in single compartment, and the ship will not sink. Wasa, okay. So there are four types of compartmentalization in IT: physicalization, virtualization, containerization, and sandboxing. Everybody heard about, I hope, about virtualization and containerization, especially today with Docker, all the hype around the Docker. But let's talk about the two others. So physicalization is basically means the opposite of virtualization. We run code in dedicated machines. There's no virtualization overhead whatsoever. There's no noisy neighbors. Nobody's stealing your CPU cycles or IOPS. And unlike EC2, there's no Netflix roommate who steals your money. Another type is a sandbox. It's basically a virtual container in which untrusted code can be safely run. So some examples of sandboxes is Zero VM and Amazon Lambda. So Zero VM basically allows you to run single thread of untrusted x86 native code. And Amazon Lambda is a new service from Amazon which allows you to run functions in the cloud without managing servers, and billing is in 100 milliseconds increments. So it's very useful. It's like a state of the art of the cloud today. Let's summarize types of compartmentalization. Again, physicalization is the absence of virtualization. We run every workload on a separate machine. Virtualization is we're taking large machine and separating it into multiple virtual machines. So it's hardware level virtualization. And containerization is also called operating system level virtualization, where multiple containers share the same Linux kernel. And there are many different implementations of sandboxing, but basically we share our user space between different sandboxed applications. So after introduction into different types of virtualization, we know that today most of our workloads run in the cloud, and cloud runs on virtual hardware. There's basically no underlying physical hardware, at least for programmers. By the way, most of the cloud today, 90% of the cloud runs on Ubuntu operating system, and if you'll check what devices your operating the instance, if you'll check operating systems on your cloud instance, you will find that it supports all the different devices like USB and floppy drives and CD-ROMs, etc. Do you really need it? So I did an experiment. I launched a fresh Ubuntu 14 EC2 instance and ran ls/dev. And this is what I get. So 64 teletype devices, 32 serial ports, a sound device on the cloud. I can beep on Amazon. I will not hear it. VGA device. So it's a legacy baggage, or in other words, it's a huge technical debt that we're carrying years over years. Paraphrasing, it's wrong on so many levels. It's duplicated on so many layers. We have many layers of IT stack. And all these layers written by different people at different types, at different times, and they have a lot of duplication between them. For example, hypervisor does isolation, containers do isolation, operating systems do isolation between processes, and even Erlang VM does isolation between Erlang processes. Same with memory management. Hypervisor manages memory, operating system manages memory, Erlang manages memory, lots of duplication, and every new layer adds additional complexity, additional overhead, and lots of inefficiency. So what's the solution? Oh, let's hold the solution. So usually when we run in the cloud, we run a single application per VM. We run it in a single user mode. But our operating system still has all this legacy support from Unix for multiple users. So why do we still use operating systems designed for the desktops in the cloud? One of the ways to solve this problem is to build minimalistic Linux operating system distributions. There are many different kinds of embedded Linux, dumb and small Linux. There's a thing called BusyBox, which is a 2.5 executable, which replaces the Linux shell and all the command line utilities. So if you take a Linux kernel and BusyBox together, you get a very minimalistic Linux operating system. Another take in it, people, if you assume that all the applications we run are basically inside containers, so let's build a minimalistic Linux operating system which is just enough to run in containers. And every day pop up, there's a new operating system for managing containers. Even Intel released a few days ago Intel Clear Linux. So I did a little experiment. I launched several operating systems in a Vagrant box and fresh, without any application installed, and measured how many processes and threads they use out of the box. And it's at least 60 to 90 processes and much more threads. And this is before we run any user application. I will talk today about new operating system called OSV. And I also did the same experiment on OSV. And OSV has an optional command line. It doesn't have shell like bash, but it has an optional command line interface, which mostly used for debugging and development. And OSV, by definition, has only single process, which is your application, and 127 threads. So OSV is a type of unikernel. For those of you who took operating system class in the college or university, we learn microkernels versus monolithic kernels. But we never learned about unikernels and anykernels, all the different types of kernels. So what's a unikernel? Unikernel is a library operating system. It's also called a library operating system. It's a kernel library linked with your actual user application. And it's a kernel that can support only single process. Both kernel and your application lives in a single address space. And there is no kernel user space separation, so cost of a context switch is really zero. For those who want to learn about it more, there's a white paper from University of Cambridge called Unikernels, Library Operating System for the Cloud. Sorry. Another interesting idea is any kernel. It's actually not a kernel at all. It's like REST, it's like architectural style or programming discipline for kernel code reuse. So you can have different subsystems of operating systems that you can mix and match like a Lego to build a new operating system. So for example, it can be a file system or user space TCP IP stack or a device driver, etc. So unikernels originally were designed to run on top of hypervisor. And now, with all these new ideas from unikernels, some unikernels like Mirage OS or Ling VM can run on bare metal without hypervisor. One interesting unikernel project, actually the first unikernel project, unikernel project I heard about, called Ling. Before that, it was called Erlang-on-Xen, and you can think about it as an extended OTP release. So Erlang itself already like an operating system. It has a shell, it has processes, and you can create an OTP release, which you can deploy in a target system. So think about it as extended OTP release, which in addition to all your OTP applications, their configuration, their dependencies, and Beam, also contains a small, lean operating system, and it becomes a truly self-contained OTP release. By the way, tomorrow, I think, will be talk from one of the authors of Ling, so it's better to attend. Another interesting project in this space called OSV, and it's the unikernel-style operating system designed from the ground up for the cloud. It's from the same people who wrote KVM hypervisor. There are lots of other unikernel projects, but in my opinion, the most, except the first two, Ling VM and OSV, the most important one is Mirage OS, which targets OCaml functional language, and it allows to create truly very tiny unikernels, like kilobytes in size. Also, usually unikernel targets some specific high-level language, and OSV is different because it targets any application which uses POSIX API or JVM application, like Java code, Scala code, Clojure code, Groovy code. And they also explore high-performance non-POSIX APIs. LingVM, on the other side, only allows running Erlang code. So I did a little experiment. I gathered information about minimal image sizes for different operating systems. And you can see that desktop operating systems like Windows and Ubuntu, even Ubuntu server, are just too big. They are outliers. Even if we take them out, we can see that OSV, Linux kernel, is about 70 megabyte, and OSV is about 20 megabyte. So we can see that OSV is halfway between unikernels and the Linux kernel. But it's the largest, or by size, by image size, unikernel among the other projects, and sometimes it's called fat unikernel. So as I said, the two types of unikernels, specialized unikernels, which can like Mirage OS or LingVM, which can compile to very small images, which boot very fast, like milliseconds fast, but they require writing all your code in high-level statically typed language like OCaml or Haskell. And the problem is, if it's a new greenfield application, there's no problem. But if you want to port existing code, it can be hard or sometimes even impossible. Another advantage of specialized unikernels is the very tiny attack surface, because you link only actual libraries you're using, And in addition to that, compiler or CAML or Haskell compiler do the static analysis and dead code elimination. So you, it's like what WYSIWYG, what you see is what you get, but for operating system. So another type of unikernels, more generic unikernels, they also called Unikernel-ish or fat unikernels. They have a little bit larger images, but still much, much smaller than Linux. They have longer boot times, but still much, much faster than Linux. They have a larger attack surface. Again, much smaller than for traditional operating systems. But they are much, much easier to port existing code to. And in my opinion, they are more pragmatic solution overall. So OSV is one example. So OTP provide as a payoff for being large and a little bit slow for a boot, it can run on top of multiple hypervisors. So I think Mirage OS or Erlang-on-Xen only support the Xen hypervisor. OSV can run on Xen, KVM, VirtualBox, all VMware hypervisors. It provides a user space TCP IP stack and ZFS file system. So in my opinion, and of course it provides almost full Linux POSIX API and Linux ABI compatibility. So in my opinion, it's a very small price to pay for easier life. People like Docker because it provides a Docker-like experience. So it has Docker CLI where you can build, run, and share Docker container images. So OSV provides something similar. It's called Capstan. And it's basically like Docker, but for OSV. So with Capstan, you can build, search, create images, virtual machine images for OSV. If you want to try OSV on your machine, install QMU and KVM, and just install Capstan, that's all. Then you can run, type Capstan run Claudio/OSV, where Claudio/OSV is the name of the official OSV image on the Claudio's repository. And if you download the operating system OSV virtual machine image and run it and create instance on your machine. So first time, Erlang is a concurrent language and it's a very good fit for the cloud. And OSV is an operating system which is designed for the cloud. So when I heard first time about OSV, my initial idea was, let's port Erlang to OSV. But it wasn't so easy. So containers add new layers versus unikernels remove layers. I will not read the citations, but I think that they're funny. So how do we run Erlang on physical machine, on dedicated physical machine? Like, for example, WhatsApp. WhatsApp running on soft layer data centers on dedicated machines with FreeBSD on top of them and Erlang on top of FreeBSD. So everything is good. We don't have virtualization overhead. But it's hard to manage because nowadays we are like to have booting different images all the time. And with dedicated hardware, it's a little bit complicated. So the solution to use another layer of hypervisor. Now we can switch and mix and switch images and boot different virtual machines. All good. But now we have two layers, operating system process, which runs inside VM, which runs on the actual hardware. And when we run on public clouds, like Amazon or Google Cloud or Rackspace or Azure, we are not in the control of hypervisor. The cloud provider chooses the hypervisor, so we can't move the image from Amazon to Azure to Google Cloud. And the solution for this, let's use containers. Containers have images, which Docker images, for example, it's a standard for container images, so we can mix and match, and we can develop a Docker container on Amazon and then run it on Google Cloud, on a Rackspace or Azure. The payoff is that trade-off that we're adding yet another layer of indirection of containers. Containers are not a secure solution. So if we need a multi-tenancy or real security, the only solution is to run container operating system distribution inside the VM. So now we have Linux running on top of hypervisor, which Linux kernel shared between different containers, and we're running a KVM inside the container and another Linux distribution inside the KVM, and then we run Erlang. So it's getting a little complicated and cumbersome. Of course, you can run, when you're running on physical machine, you can run containers directly on top of your machine, on top of the OS, so without virtualization. But then again, if you need the multi-tenancy or security, you need the KVM inside the container. Now compare all I said before it with this diagram. We have hypervisor, and we have like VM, which is basically an extended OTP release, and not all, and there is no all the stupid layers like we saw in previous pictures. This is what unikernel means, and this is how Erlang on OSv works. And basically, the same is a Ling VM, but with the difference that Ling VM can only run on specific Xen hypervisor, and now they can also run on bare metal, which is very useful in embedded applications. As I said, my first idea was when I heard about OSv, I wanted to port Erlang to OSv, and it wasn't easy, but I said to myself, OSv has a built-in support for JVM, so it's basically you don't need any porting. You just copy your jar files to the OSv image, and it's supposed to run. With some exception, like it's still, if your JVM code does fork, it will not work. So I tried to run Erlang on OSv. Erlang, for those who don't know, is the Erlang for JVM. So I created a capstan file, which is the OSv analog of Docker file, and it's very similar to Docker file. So you have a base, which means from which, it's like a from in Dockerfile, from which image do we start building our new OSv image, and Claudius, the company behind OSv, already has OSv image with JVM. Then you need to provide a command line, a starting command line. Now notice that java.so, it's a JVM, and all executables in OSv are shared objects. The build is a section which run when we run capstan build. It's a shell script which will download the Erlang jar file. And file section, it's similar to add a Docker files. It basically says which take this file from your local repository, from your local folder, and add it to the image we're building at some specific location. So now, if you type capstan build, it will download the JDK OSv image, and add Erlang jar, and we'll create an Erlang OSV image. And if you then run capstan run, it will start OSV virtual machine image with Erlang. As you can see, it works more or less. Porting JVM application in OSV is very easy. It's basically copying jar files to the image. But porting a native C++ application to OSV is possible, but a little bit more complicated. First of all, still OSV doesn't allow fork or exec. If your application does fork or exec, out of luck. But you need to do two things. Recompile your code as a position-independent code, minus fpic flag. And you need to build your executable as a shared object. Actually, a newer way to do this, which I will not discuss, so you may compile your executable as a position-independent executable, and then it will not be a shared object. It will be usual executable that which you can run both on Linux and on OSV, unmodified. And in their long-term plans, they want you to be able to take unmodified Linux executables and run them on OSV. Right now, you can take only unmodified shared objects from the Linux and run them on OSV. So basic hello world in C, C++. As I said, we modify, we compile it as a position-independent code. We build a shared object. And then this is the capstan file. Again, analog of a Docker file for OSV. We start with the base image for OSV. We run make, we add the compilation output to the image, and the entry point is the command line. Now, if we run capstan build, it will build the image with our hello world executable. And if we type capstan run, it will launch a VM with the OSV image, which basically is the operating system kernel linked with the hello world printf. So I explained all this to show that it requires some work to port Erlang OTP to OSV, as Erlang OTP is written in C. The biggest problem that there are no forks or exec in OSV, but Erlang loves forks. I did a grep on OTP source code, and I found lots of shell scripts and lots of ports. So the standard way of communicating with the outside world in Erlang is ports. And port, I guess everybody here knows how Erlang ports works, but I stole a few slides from Ulf Wigger's presentation to show it. So the yellow circle is an Erlang process, and the green box is an Erlang port. So Erlang port is like a middleman, a proxy, which allows external operating system processes to pretend to be just another Erlang process. And then port facilitates the communication between the Erlang process and the external operating system process with regular Erlang message passing. So the process sends the message to the port. Port marshals it over the Unix pipe or TCP socket. External operating system receives it and send the reply. Port unmarshals it and send the regular Erlang message to the Erlang process. And this happens a lot in Erlang VM because Erlang VM uses a lot of ports for I/O and communicating with the operating system. Port is just one of the interop or FFI mechanisms in Erlang. The other one are LinkedIn drivers and native implemented functions, which usually implemented as a shared object. And the difference between them that NIF, you can link it as like a JNI into your into VM, both with LinkedIn drivers, but for NIF you just call functions like in JNI in Java, but for LinkedIn drivers you need to implement some custom marshalling and marshalling protocol. So how do we adapt all the existing ports in Erlang to OSV? So the only solution is to rewrite them as LinkedIn drivers, which using POSIX threads, with some exceptions. So there is the port of Erlang OTP to OSV was done by OSV community. So again, I ported Erlang to OSV. I just basically copied a few jar files. I tried to port official Ericsson Erlang OTP, but again, I lost myself in all these make files, and I did grab and find a lot of shell scripts and ports. And frankly, I thought it's impossible to port Erlang OTP to OSV. And the company behind OSV, Claudius, they are not so much focused in Erlang. Their focus is POSIX, JVM, and exploring high-performance networking, non-POSIX APIs. And there was a lot of discussion, not a lot, there was some discussion on OSV mailing list, and but there was no progress. So until like half a year ago, several people finally ported Erlang to OSV. Most of the work was done by Yao Zheng. He also ported Elixir and LFE and Yo's web server. So what are the most important executables in Erlang OTP? Of course, it's ERL, which is a wrapper to Erl-exec, EPMD, Erlang port mapping daemon. Without EPMD, Erlang distribution will not work. There's a heart, which is a watchdog for Beam. We can live without heart, I think. And INET get host is a native DNS resolver. OSMON, it's all the monitoring of memory and disk and CPU load. And ODBC server for DBC connectivity. There are some more, but those, I think, most important ones. So the ERL was just there was some Jao, the guy who ported the Erlang to OSV, who wrote a simple wrapper, which is the shared object, because OSV executables are shared object. We just passed some arguments and CLI parameters to Erl-exec. So it looks like this. You have Erlang.so, and you may pass different environment variables and VM args. Of course, we start with the base OSV image. And the process of building the image, it's like you run make on the Linux. It's like cross-compiling. And then when you run make install, you install your newly compiled Erlang VM and in the special folder called rootfs. And then you just copy this folder to the new image you're building. And at least at the proof of concept stage, it works. You can run Erlang on OSV now. So, but how do we port Erlang port mapper daemon? There were two options: to write pure Erlang implementation of EPMD, some of them on GitHub, or find something else. And what was done, instead of writing running a PMD as a separate operating system executable, there was a way to run it as a POSIX thread. So this is the way it was selected, and I asking myself how a PMD implemented in Erlang on real-time operating systems like VxWorks or Inea OSE, and maybe we may use this way on OSV too. So right now, if you trying to work with like trying to do HTTP request to open the socket with the host name instead of IP address, you will receive an error on OSV because it tries to fork and run inet get host port. And the solution is to force Erlang to use pure Erlang DNS resolver, and it's a default in Erlang on VxWorks and Inea OSE real-time operating systems. This modification isn't finished yet, but it almost works. For OSmon has OSmon, it's a OTP Erlang OTP application which monitoring the system. So disk SAP and map SAP and CPU SAP are ports, are separate executables. So it was relatively easy to rewrite them as POSIX threads, LinkedIn drivers running POSIX thread. So as I said, the best way to think about Unikernel for Erlang as extended OTP release, self-contained OTP release, which includes your OTP applications, your configuration, your BIM Erlang VM, and the operating system to run your BIM. Right now, the porting process is there's a OSV apps repository in Claudio's systems organization on GitHub, and it has a lot of applications which already ported. And Erlang is just a folder, single folder in this repository. But the actual port is just a set of patch files. I think that much better way will be to have a branch or a pull request on official Erlang OTP repository, because it's possible to compile official OTP to OSV, unlike other implementation like Ling. So there are many reasons to run Unikernels, but I will not list all of them. But most important one is the high performance networking and I/O. So, long time before Erlang the movie, telephone switches worked like this. There were telephone switchboard operators, and there was a data plane and a control plane, and there were a lot of two supervisors, many worker processes, and each worker process had a headphones through which she received the messages, and a mic through which sending the messages, and then they insert the sockets into the ports. So it's basically Erlang. It's basically OTP, supervisor and GAN server, etc. So Erlang OTP is a very good fit for control plane, but not so good for data plane. The data plane was handled by specialized hardware or real-time operating systems, as we can see in Erlang the movie. So now with this Unikernel technology, with things like Ling VM and OSV, it's finally possible to use Erlang for both control plane and data plane. So in traditional operating systems like Linux, IO and TCP/IP, implemented as via system calls, which has a kernel overhead. But many unikernels, including OSV and Ling VM, have a user space TCP/IP stack. So there is no overhead. And in addition, OSV implemented the Van Jacobsen net channel optimization. So these solutions are optimized for network functionality, virtualization, and software-defined networking applications. It's already possible with Ling VM, Erlang-on-Xen. Erlang in OSV is still not a good fit for this. It's only possible with non-POSIX APIs in C++, not in C++ 11, not in Erlang, but it might be possible in the future. So, and the last slide, let's compare Ling VM, Erlang-on-Xen with OSV, Erlang OTP, standard Ericsson Erlang OTP ported to OSV operating system. So Ling VM has their own implementation of Erlang VM, it's not BIM. And the last update of the VM was half a year ago. Erlang on OSV, you just download or fork your standard Erlang OTP on GitHub, and it should compile and work. The latest we tested 17.3, but it should work at 75, even in 18. So Ling VM is production grade. It's already three and a half years. Erlang port to OSV is only 6 months old. Ling VM uses proprietary SleepyCat license. OSV uses BSD clause, BSD license. Erlang-on-Xen guys don't like SMP, don't like threads. They think that you need to launch new VM for parallel activity. OSV has a good support for SMP and multithreading, so it's possible to do Erlang with SMP on OSV. Of course, both can't support ports because it implies forks. NIFs possible on OSV, I don't know about Ling. Hype is possible on OSV. In my opinion, it's not possible on Ling because Ling is their own implementation of a VM. But Ling VM has a special API for disabling garbage collection. Ling runs on Xen hypervisor only. OSV supports almost all the hypervisors out there. But Ling can run on bare metal. Again, OSV supports much more clouds. The difference between image sizes, like Ling VM image is half of OSV image, but it boots like in 100 milliseconds, while OSV is still slow. It takes up to a second to boot. Both have tools for building images. For Ling, it's called Railing, and for OSV, it's called Capstan. Both has file systems. Ling has non-standard GUIFS file system from Plan, inspired by Plan 9. OSV has ZFS from BSD. With Ling VM, it's already possible to write data plane applications. With Erlang on OSV, it's not possible today, maybe in the future, but it's possible if you write a C++ code. So takeaways. So it seems that after Docker, unikernels are going to be the next big thing in the cloud. Erlang community now has two options to choose from. So try both. Try to port your Erlang application. Try to port your favorite open source Erlang application, but only when it makes sense. So go download OSV or fork OSV and help porting standard Ericsson's Erlang OTP to OSV. And this is it's not the official repository, it's just a place where you can find all the links to and bookmarks and more information. So and now, thank you for coming, and I'll be happy to take questions or answer questions.
We probably have time for, say, two questions. People will be needing the coffee. No takers? Well, in that case, let's...
I have a question to myself.
All right. Well, let's have it.
I'm kidding.